All right. Well, thanks for having me here this morning. I'm excited to share God's word with you. Turn in your Bibles to Daniel chapter 2. That's where we're going to be this morning. Yesterday, I was able to be at a wedding, the wedding of our junior high pastor, Cameron Baker, and married his amazing wife, Sarah. And So we love them. They met in junior high here in youth group and have basically been in love since. So they got married yesterday, so we're super stoked for them. So what usually we do in youth ministry, actually, when somebody has a pretty big important thing in their life is on a Sunday, we'll pull out all of our phones and text them like a congratulations. So if you would, Cameron's number is 805. No, I'm just kidding. That would be pretty awesome. So all the high school students are texting right now. So, man, could you imagine first morning of being married and your phone's blowing up? So, yeah, well, awesome. Well, Daniel chapter 2 is where we're going to be this morning. We're continuing on with this vision that King Nebuchadnezzar had, and Daniel brings to him an interpretation. So Daniel chapter 2 is where we'll be. Let's pray and ask God to bless his word this morning. Lord Jesus, we thank you for being among us, Lord, that your word is here, your spirit is here, and you're moving here, God, and we love that, God. We come here every Sunday expecting to receive something from your word. And Lord, we know in Revelation it says that when prophecy is read aloud, the hearer is blessed. And God, we're here with open ears, open hearts, open minds to receive from this prophecy recorded in Daniel. And God, we ask that you would move among us now through your word, and we will thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So Daniel and his three friends were taken from their home and placed into government service for the king Nebuchadnezzar in the kingdom of Babylon. And as we've been going through this series of Daniel, we've been looking at how Daniel was able to remain a man of the spirit, right? A man without compromise, even in the midst of some really spiritually challenging conditions. And, you know, we've just been looking at how King Nebuchadnezzar last week, Nate taught, and he talked about how he had a dream, and he brought all these wise men. Daniel was among these wise men, but he brought all these wise men and said, tell me what my dream was. Like, I'm not even going to tell you what the dream was, and then you can interpret. I want to know the dream first, and then you can tell me the interpretation. And if you don't, I'm going to rip your limbs off, right? Literally, he says that. And we saw last week as these wise men were standing before this powerful and mighty king, and they're just like, I don't know. I don't know the dream and the interpretation. They couldn't tell the king his dream. So the king issued a decree that he would have every single wise man in Babylon killed. And so with this death sentence going, Daniel and his three friends were among those wise men. They would be victims of this death order. Daniel goes to prayer like anybody would. I mean, if you have a death sentence coming your way, you're gonna pray, right? So Daniel begins to pray and to seek the Lord. And one night as Daniel goes to sleep, the Lord speaks to him through this night vision and shares the same exact dream that King Nebuchadnezzar had and also gives him the interpretation of that dream. And that's what we're going to be looking at this morning, which is the interpretation of the king's dream. Starting in verse 24, let's take a look. It says, therefore, Daniel went to Arioch, whom the king had appointed to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and said thus to him, do not destroy the wise men of Babylon. Take me before the king, and I will tell the king the interpretation. So Daniel goes right to this main advisor of the king, the man Arioch. I could imagine that Arioch was pretty stoked at this point because he was going out around the Babylonian kingdom, rounding up all these wise men, several hundred probably, ready to kill them. This mass death, right? And Arioch has this man, Daniel, come and say, I know the dream. And so the two of them, working against the clock, are going to go to the king and tell him the interpretation of the dream. But can you imagine right now Daniel and the way that he was? I mean, he must have had a certain level of confidence, right? I mean, he knows that the God of heaven has told him the dream and told him the interpretation, so Daniel can go and stand in the presence of this king and be pretty confident. And that makes me think of how we as Christians ought to be. We as Christians ought to have a level of confidence that Daniel had, if not more confidence than Daniel had. The reason I'm able to say we can have more confidence than Daniel is because Daniel only had a limited scope of revelation in the times that he lived. We have living today in the new covenant promises that Jesus has spoken to us, mysteries that he's revealed to us that Daniel had no idea about. We read, for instance, in Ephesians chapter 1, that the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ, was given to us. We also read in Colossians chapter 1 that the church itself, literally what we're doing here right now this Sunday, is a mystery that was hidden for ages and generations, but is now revealed in the saints. Guys, literally what we're doing right here, right now, this Sunday, Daniel had no clue about. We have promises, we have amazing things that we can go to the bank on. Think, for instance, in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1. Literally, the opening verse of Hebrews says this. It says, in times past, God spoke through the prophets, right? Like Daniel. But in these last days, he spoke to us by his son. We have promises from the very mouth of Jesus. And if we have promises from the very mouth of Jesus, we ought to have more confidence than even Daniel had. There's just a little application there as we continue to make our way into this text. Let's read now verse 25. It says, then Arioch quickly brought Daniel before the king and said thus to him, I have found a man of the captives of Judah who will make known to the king the interpretation. So the wise men of Babylon are probably right now being rounded up for their death. And Daniel and Arioch are working against the clock. And I noticed something here that's kind of interesting, right? It says that Arioch said he found Daniel to bring him before the king. Don't you think Arioch's taking a little bit too much credit here, right? Wasn't it Daniel who sought out Arioch, not the other way around, right? So Arioch's coming before the king and trying to save his own skin, right? And Arioch is sort of a picture of how most people are, right? That we're so quick to cast off our failures and to blame others, and to take credit for the achievements that don't belong to us, right? And Arioch's doing this. He's taking a little bit too much credit. Well, now we have Daniel standing in the presence of the king, ready to tell the king this dream and its interpretation. Let's read down verse 26. It says, the king answered and said to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, are you able to make known to me the dream which I have seen and its interpretation? You know, you kind of picture this big, mighty, strong king who's really powerful and kind of crazy and sort of intimidating Daniel. But Daniel is here standing in the presence of the king with this confidence again that is just so amazing. So verse 27 to 28, Daniel says, Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secret which the king has demanded, the wise men and the astrologers, the magicians and the soothsayers cannot declare to the king. But there's a God in heaven who reveals secrets, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. Your dream and the visions of your head upon your bed were these. I love this. I love this. Daniel is giving credit to where credit is due. Daniel gives credit to where credit is due. He takes the credit away from the wise men who for too long, by their gimmicks and lies, had sort of made their way in the kingdom, right? But they'd come up short, and their lies had brought them to the brink of death. Daniel wasn't even going to let Arioch take the spotlight here. Did you notice this too, that Daniel doesn't take any credit for the dream or its interpretation? If you notice in the text there, Daniel never even uses a personal pronoun, his own personal pronoun. There's no I, there's no we, right? Do you think that if we were to read that text and were to read Daniel say, I know the vision, I know the dream, I know the interpretation, let me tell you. that we would even bat an eye to that? See, but Daniel is casting all credit upon God. He's giving God all the glory for this dream and for its interpretation. And so now let's look at verse 29 and 30. It says, "As for you, O king, thoughts came to your mind upon your bed about what would come to pass after this. And he who reveals secrets has made known to you what will be. But as for me, the secret has not been revealed to me because I have more wisdom than anyone living. But for our sakes who make known the interpretation to the king and that you may know the thoughts of your head." So Daniel is just continuing to give credit to God and saying, God's the one who gave you the dream, king. God's the one who gave me the interpretation. And God's going to get all the credit for this. Now, as we sort of come into this dream, we need to understand the role of King Nebuchadnezzar at this time, the sort of man that he was. See, King Nebuchadnezzar's father, when he died, the King Nebuchadnezzar, he consolidated all power to himself. Any power that existed in Babylon belonged to King Nebuchadnezzar so that he could make those sort of decrees that he did where he could just say, kill everybody, right? And okay, let's do that, right? Because he had that sort of level of authority. And as we make our way into this dream, God's going to speak to the king and tell him about his authority. So let's look now as we read this dream that the king had, starting at verse 31. It says, "You, O king, were watching, and behold, a great image. This great image, whose splendor was excellent, stood before you, and its form was awesome. The image's head was of fine gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. You watched while a stone was cut out without hands, which struck the image at its feet of iron and clay and broke them into pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were crushed together and became like chaff from the summer threshing floor. The wind carried them away so that no trace of them was found. The stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream." All right, so what we need to do with this dream is we need to sort of construct, right, this image in our minds about what Daniel, what the king was seeing. There's this image that's of a man that has different sections that are composed of metals. And this image was great. It was mesmerizing. One translation might say terrified. The New King James says it was awesome. Sort of like, you know, if you were to see a picture of Niagara Falls or the Grand Canyon, you kind of give it like a head nod, like, oh, that's, you know, pretty cool. But if you actually stand and see something like the Grand Canyon, it's awe-inspiring. It's awesome. And that's the way that the king felt when he saw this great image of a man standing before him. And you notice it said it was standing before him, meaning King Nebuchadnezzar felt so small and tiny. This image wasn't like a little G.I. Joe, right? It was like this big, massive image of a man. And the king felt so small. Now, as we're going to take this image, we're going to go from the head to the toes. And we're going to see the different sections, which are a prophetic picture that is given. And we'll look at it and bring some understanding to it. So we have this image. We have a head of fine gold. We have a chest and arms of silver. We have the belly and the thighs of bronze. We have legs of iron. And we have feet of iron and clay mixed together. And as Daniel continues to describe, right, this vision, which right would have looked something like that. Not like that. It's like a lousy cartoon. But, you know, it's this big image of a man. And then he says that there's this stone that is cut out without hands, which speaks of its origin, that it comes from heaven. And it comes down and it comes crashing down at the feet of this image and breaks it to pieces. And the whole image disintegrates into like dust, like chaff in the summer threshing floor, right? And blows away, and then this stone that comes crashing down, it's going to then turn into this mountain that fills the whole earth. Now, it's not recorded here that King Nebuchadnezzar says anything. You sort of just think that he's like, wow, that's the dream, right? And now Daniel is going to give the king the interpretation of the dream. And that's what we're going to look at now, the interpretation of this vision. We got quite a bit to read here, so we're going to start in verse 36 and read along with me. Look down in your Bibles and see what it says. It says, "This is the dream. Now we will tell you the interpretation of it before the king. You, O king, are a king of kings. For the God of heaven has given you a kingdom, power, strength, and glory. And wherever the children of men dwell, or the beasts of the fields, or the birds of the air, he has given them into your hand and has made you ruler over them all. You are the head of gold. But after you shall arise another kingdom, inferior to yours, then another, a third kingdom of bronze, which shall rule over all the earth. And the fourth kingdom shall be as iron, as strong as iron, inasmuch as iron breaks in pieces and shatters everything. And like iron that crushes, that kingdom will break in pieces and crush all the others. Whereas you saw the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly iron, the kingdom shall be divided. Yet the strength of the iron shall be in it, just as you saw the iron mixed with ceramic clay. And as the toes of the feet were partly iron and partly clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly fragile. And as you saw iron mixed with ceramic clay, they will mingle with the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, just as iron does not mix with clay. And in the days of these kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. The kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Inasmuch as you saw the stone that was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it broke in pieces, the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what will come to pass after this. The dream is certain, and its interpretation is sure." Whew, right? So, what is this dream? What is this interpretation? We sort of have to, right, interpret the interpretation. So we're going to now walk through and look at this interpretation. We're going to see this image of a man starting at its head and working its way down to the toes and see what this prophecy is speaking about. Now, this is a prophecy which Bible students and expositors and scholars have looked at, and taking Bible prophecy, what you need to do is you need to use scripture to interpret scripture, right? And then you need to also pair it up with history and see the fulfillment of the things that are spoken of. And as we look at this prophecy, we're going to see these different kingdoms of history past and also this kingdom of the future that hasn't even been fulfilled yet. So we're going to look at this prophecy today and see what God was speaking to Nebuchadnezzar and what he speaks to us today. So first, starting at the head, working our way down to the toes, we're going to see this prophecy. Starting at the head, Daniel says that the head was Babylon. He said that in Daniel 2 verse 38, that Nebuchadnezzar was the head of gold. As we work our way down, we're going to see that there's these successive kingdoms, right? So all of these kingdoms came one after another in history, and we can match this prophecy up with history and see that Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome all came as these successive kingdoms, right? So Babylon fell to the kingdom of the Medes and the Persians. We're gonna study this. Don't worry if this is like, whoa, hold on, right? We're going to study this more as we go through the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 5, verse 26 to 31, we're going to see that King Darius and King Cyrus come in and they conquer Babylon, besiege Babylon, and take it over and set up their empire. We're going to then read in Daniel chapter 8, Daniel chapter 10, and Daniel 11, that Greece will become the successors to the Medo-Persian Empire. Then after that, we look at this last section, which is made of iron, and the book of Daniel, the Bible never specifically says that this kingdom was actually Rome, but if you match it up with history, you'll see that Rome came into power after Greece, right? And Rome was known as the Iron Empire because they would crush those whom they conquered. They were known to have an iron heel, and they would destroy everybody in their way. The last section, which we'll look at, which technically is part of the fourth, but we'll look at the feet, which is commonly understood by biblical students to be yet future. This hasn't happened yet. And we'll see some prophecies in Daniel and Revelation that will speak of this coming kingdom of 10 kings. So let's look then at each kingdom, all right? We're going to look first at the head of gold, which was Babylon, starting there. So Daniel calls Nebuchadnezzar, this king, he calls him a king of kings. Doesn't that just feel weird, right? Because who's the king of kings, right? Jesus. We know Jesus to be the king of kings, but Nebuchadnezzar is given this title is because he's a king over many kings. And he has this authority that was so powerful. In fact, if you read it, it says there the language that's used is so similar to the Genesis language where you read how, right, God gave authority to Adam and Eve over all the beasts of the field, right, over every living creature. That same language is used by God spoken to Nebuchadnezzar. God gave Nebuchadnezzar a level of power and authority. It says there, right, that he gave him a kingdom. He gave him power. He gave him strength. He gave him glory, unlike any other nation that would follow. And we read in right, Romans 13:1, this passage is very familiar to us, that there is no authority except from God. And those which exist are established by God. That God is the one who put King Nebuchadnezzar in his place and established him there. We also read in verse 21 of chapter 2, Nate spoke about this last week, that God removes kings and he establishes kings. So God had put King Nebuchadnezzar in this place of authority. Then we're going to move down to the Medo-Persian Empire, which I said already that was fulfilled in 539 BC when Cyrus, the king of Persia, and Darius, the king of the Medes, came and besieged Babylon. We're going to see this take place in Daniel chapter 5. As we make our way down the body of the image, we're not going to spend as much time in there because Daniel doesn't. He only briefly mentions the second and third kingdom. The third kingdom is the Greek Empire, which was under the leadership of Alexander the Great. How many of you guys heard of Alexander the Great in history class, right? Yeah, okay, we're right back there. Alexander the Great, the man who conquered basically all of the known world. It said that at the age of 33, he's like, ah, I have nothing left to do. I've conquered the whole world, right? He was sad about that. He had a kingdom. The Greek Empire lasted from 331 BC to 146 BC. Again, a good long reign, but look at what we're seeing here. We're seeing as we move from the top to the bottom, just as gold and silver and bronze, as those metals lose purity, right? That there's this strength that is lost, this purity that is lost in those kingdoms as we make our way through history. Sort of think about it like this. You guys know how water, as it flows downstream, becomes less pure as it makes its way downstream, right? You want to get the water at the top or at the top of the glacier. That's where it's most pure. As it moves downstream, it becomes more and more impure. And that's what we're seeing in this prophecy, that human history and human government, as we've made our way from the kingdom of Babylon, that is becoming more and more scattered in its power and more impure in its ways. That brings us then to the fourth kingdom, which Daniel describes, which is the kingdom of iron. Iron is a hard metal that crushes, right? And we know this to be the Roman Empire that crushed just about everybody in its wake. See, when Rome conquered people, it wasn't enough just to take their land and say, pay us taxes. They'd slaughter people. You guys have seen the movies, right? Gladiators, stuff like that, right? Great movies, but they were brutal, right? The Romans were the ones who perfected the cross. They didn't invent it, but they perfected it. And it says that the Roman roads would be lined with crosses. And crosses for the Romans were basically like billboards, which sent this message: don't mess with Rome. If you mess with Rome, if you rebel against Rome, you will be crucified. And that is exactly how Rome ruled for so long, a great long kingdom. Now, we're going to look at this last kingdom, which is sort of an extension of the fourth, sort of a revival of the fourth, which is yet future. which is the kingdom that is of the 10 toes, of this iron that is mixed with clay. There is so much in here that you can dig out, which I hope that you would in your own studies or in your life groups. But we're going to look at how this is something that has not yet happened, but it certainly will. This vision, which is yet future, is a picture of 10 kings that rule kingdoms, a sort of a confederacy of kings. As you take Daniel chapter 2 and compare it with Daniel chapter 7, Daniel 7 is basically the same interpretation of a vision, but instead of a man composed of precious metals, it's a different beast, fierce beasts. And so you take Daniel 2, you compare it with Daniel 7, and then you also open up to Revelation. You look at Revelation chapter 12, Revelation 13, Revelation 17. What we're going to see in this 10-king confederacy is that the Antichrist is going to arise within these 10 kings. He's going to destroy three of them, and then he's going to wage war against the Lamb of God. In Revelation chapter 17, we read that an angel describes this vision to the Apostle John, and this is what he writes. Revelation 17, verse 12 through 14. It's on the screen. Read it with me. The 10 horns which you saw are 10 kings which have received no kingdom as yet, but they will receive authority for 1 hour as kings with the beast. These are of one mind, and they will give their power and authority to the beast. These will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them, for he is the Lord of lords and the King of kings, and those who are with him are called, chosen, and faithful. Man, I'd love to spend so much more time looking at this part, but we have to move on. And we read then verse 44 to 45, which is my favorite part of this passage. Let's take a look. And in the days of these kings, right, the 10 kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people. And it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Inasmuch as you saw that stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what will come to pass after this. The dream is certain, and its interpretation is sure. So what is the stone? What is this stone that is cut out of the mountain without hands? It's Jesus, right? If you read from Genesis to Revelation, and you do a word study, you look at any time the Bible mentions a stone, it is always idiomatic, almost always idiomatic, or a picture of Jesus Christ. For instance, in the wilderness, there was the rock that Moses struck and water came forth, right? Paul tells us in Corinthians that that rock was Jesus. Right, we also know the psalm, and in 1 Peter, the stone that was rejected by the builders became the chief cornerstone. What's the chief cornerstone? It's Jesus, right? And so what is the stone then in this prophecy? It's Jesus. Guys, this is pretty plain and simple. Let me just tell you plainly right now what this is telling us. Jesus is coming back. He's coming back, and he's going to set up a kingdom. And it will be the only kingdom that will exist after that. And when it comes, it's going to crush every other kingdom that existed before it. It will wipe out all kingdoms, and they will disintegrate like dust in the wind as Jesus comes and sets up his kingdom. It's like a mountain that's going to cover the whole earth. See, Christ came once already. We know that. He came and he died on the cross for the sins of the world, and he rose from the dead, and he's exalted on high in heaven. And Jesus taught us in his first coming all about the kingdom of God. We just studied the Sermon on the Mount, which tells us what it means to be citizens of the kingdom of God, about how we do not belong to this world. We belong to a different kingdom, a kingdom that is of heaven. Right? And when the Bible talks about the kingdom of God, it's a pretty broad term. What I like to say about the kingdom is it's both now and not yet. The kingdom is here, the kingdom is now, right? We pray, let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. So the kingdom is here, but certainly there's an aspect of the kingdom of God that has not come yet. Because Jesus, at his second coming, he is bringing a kingdom that will wipe out all other kingdoms. He will not share his dominion with anybody else. He will establish his theocracy and wipe out every single form of human government that's ever existed on the face of the earth. And Jesus will rule and reign as the King of Kings with the rod of iron. Amen? Amen. So this is what is coming. This is what is coming. But guys, we need to understand this, that we are living here in a kingdom of man, right? We have human government all around us, but there is a different form of government to which we ascribe allegiance, to the kingdom of heaven. But we need to stop polishing the metal image. We need to get our eyes off of that metal image of human government, and we need to place it upon Jesus, the rock, and his kingdom. See, as this prophecy has shown us, we as humanity are not getting better. We are not getting stronger as people. We are not getting, certainly we're not getting more unified as people. Right? Power is spreading out as we make our way throughout human history. Since the time of Nebuchadnezzar, the purity and strength of human government is dwindling. But guys, we've been trained to think, right, that democracy is the greatest thing that's ever happened. Right? And don't get me wrong, democracy is amazing, and I love the country upon which we live and the way that democracy works, but it's just one other form of human government. And when Jesus comes back, guess what? He's gonna crash in and destroy even human democracy. And it's gonna be like chaff in the summer wind. And he will come and he will set up his kingdom. Now, as we look here, as we close up this morning, we're going to see how King Nebuchadnezzar responded to this dream and its interpretation. Look in verse 46. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell on his face, prostrate before Daniel. He was humbled by this. And he commanded that they should present an offering and incense to him. The king answered Daniel and said, "Truly your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and a revealer of secrets, since you could reveal this secret." Then the king promoted Daniel and gave him many great gifts and made him ruler over the whole province of Babylon and chief administrator over all the wise men of Babylon. Also, Daniel petitioned the king, and he set Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego over the affairs of the province of Babylon, but Daniel sat in the gate of the king. So as we close up here this morning, are we going to respond to this prophecy in the same way that Nebuchadnezzar responded? See, there's a right way to respond, and there's a wrong way to respond. You see, Nebuchadnezzar fell on his face. He was humbled by this, which is a very good thing. See, but his worship was misdirected at first. He gave too much credit to Daniel. He didn't give credit to where credit was due. He wanted to offer incense and worship to Daniel. We don't believe that Daniel would have accepted that. But we need to understand something right here, because many of us are like King Nebuchadnezzar. We trust too much in human beings to get us into the kingdom of God. See, there's a work that needs to be done by the Spirit of God in a person of God as they surrender to Jesus in his death and resurrection, that we would believe by faith that Jesus Christ died on the cross because we're a sinner. And that, like that image, which will be crushed to dust, we deserve to be crushed to dust. But Jesus Christ came humbly, died on the cross, and was crushed by God for our sins. He took the crushing for us. He bore the penalty of sin and death that we deserve. And you see, Daniel had no power to save King Nebuchadnezzar. He was simply a messenger for God, telling Daniel about his kingdom. And that's all I'm doing here this morning. All I'm doing here is telling you that there is a kingdom that is not of this world, And Jesus is the king of it, and you can put your faith, hope, and trust in him because his kingdom will stand forever. If you notice, it says that there will be no king to rule or reign after the kingdom of God comes. He will share his dominion with no one after that. And so what does that mean? That means that the kingdom of God is for all of eternity. And we could put hope in Jesus today and be brought in as children of the kingdom of God if we trust Jesus. If we say, like Nebuchadnezzar, truly your God is a God of gods, the Lord of kings, the revealer of secrets. Daniel was promoted by the king and brought to be a great leader in this nation. As we close here, where are we in the story, right? A lot of us would like to think like that we're Daniel in the story, because Daniel's a great guy, and I want to be a Daniel, right? Good one. My name's Daniel, right? So, man. We want to be like Daniel. But if there's anyone like Daniel, it's actually Jesus. See, like Daniel, Jesus humbled himself. Like Daniel, Jesus left his home and became one of the wise men. And in the face of death, Daniel, like Jesus, became a spokesman for his friends. See, Jesus took it so much further with Daniel, though, because by the certainty of his death and resurrection, he brings us with him as friends. See, we are the other wise men in the story who are just like shivering in the face of death, like ready to be executed. But our Daniel, King Jesus, comes in and brings us with him, brings us into his kingdom, lets us rule and reign with him. We will rule and reign with Jesus in his second coming. Isn't that amazing? We have a great hope. We have a great certainty in King Jesus. He came once, he's coming again, and he's bringing with him a kingdom that has no end. It will destroy every kingdom that has ever existed, whether of human government or your own right kingdom that you've made for yourself. So we, as we close now, let's fix our eyes on Jesus. Lord God, thank you for this morning. God, I thank you for your word and this prophecy which speaks so powerfully that you're coming back, Lord. It could happen anytime, and God, we want to be ready. We want to be sober-minded. So God, take our eyes off of earthly things. Point them up. Get our eyes upon you, Jesus. And Lord, we love you. We thank you that in your death, you've brought us forgiveness of sins. You've invited us into the kingdom. And in your kingdom, which will come, we will share with you in all of your glory. Thank you, Lord. We praise you in your name. Amen. Amen.